and welcome to the first talk at Chaos West. It will be with me, Khaleesi, and also Paldium. The name is Let's Review Code Together, Einfach mal machen. The talk will be in German, however, it's translated by the amazing C3 Lingo team. It's track one. Herzlich willkommen zu unserem
Hello talk and welcome to our talk Let's Review Code. This talk originated from a Sunday afternoon talk at a time when we actually wanted to do code reviews. And we were waiting for other people in the code review group. We were wondering, why are we doing code reviews in our spare time? And why aren't there more people doing this?
That's Khaleesi.
I am studying computer science at an applied university. You can also find me in the C3 News Show.
Security Themen.
Or some security topics.
The part unseres speaker teams is Paldium.
Genau. The second speaker is Paldium. I'm 37 years old, working as a software architect. I have to do a lot with code reviews, of course. And if I'm doing this in my spare time, if I find the time, I'm also doing code reviews, partly in the OpenBSD environment, Linux Infinite, and other stuff. The question that we were wondering about is, what is a code review? Why are people doing that? And why is it very important to ask questions?
Review im Duden ist erstmal eine kritische Besprechung.
Code review in the dictionary is a critical examination of code or a product.
Die meisten von euch kennen es aber wahrscheinlich.
Code is art, we all know that. But most people probably know this from the professional environment, mostly as a tool for quality assurance in companies. Or as part of the software development life cycle. So basically, this means the code you've just written is being passed on to a senior developer who is reviewing the code, checks if all the conventions have been adhered to, if there are any mistakes in this code, and so on.
Wir machen das jetzt schon im professionellen Umfeld die ganze Zeit.
So the question is, we're doing this in a professional environment, but how about doing this in your spare time?
Kommen wir auch zu unserer Mission.
And this leads us to our mission.
Unicorns.
We are looking for unicorns. They're quite rare, but hopefully we'll find a few more people who we can motivate to also do code reviews in their spare time. Our mission is to motivate people to take some time and look at open source projects, look at the code in detail, and maybe even write more readable comments, which can also be part of code reviews.
So
basically, just to look at how the tools work that we take for granted and get a better technical understanding about how they are all put together.
Wir haben uns sehr viel damit auseinandergesetzt, was man machen kann, damit
quite a bit with the question of how we can motivate people to do this. And we asked ourselves, what exactly is our motivation to do code reviews? So I just kind of stumbled into this. I'm going to talk about this later. Paldium has been doing this for longer than I have, so he thought about what the motivation is.
Sehr wichtiges Thema.
So motivation is a very important topic. So when we approach you to ask you to do something, the question is, why would you do that? We thought about this and figured that we could do this in the form of a diagram with various factors. Two factors are altruism and egoism. Of course, there are a few more, but we're going to limit it to these two. A very egoistic goal is that a person looks at source code and tries to find security leaks and sell that as an exploit. It is one way to approach it, but I just want to disappoint people who do it this way. You can do it, but it's not exactly profitable if you do it only for monetary reasons. I would not advise this. So would be better to use things like static code analysis. So how do you, as the reviewer yourself, profit from doing code reviews? So one important factor is that you can increase your own competencies. So when I was still at school, I was interested in programming already. I was able to put together little programs. But at some stage, you are wondering, am I good enough to do this in a professional environment already? So can I write programs who do what they're supposed to do, in my opinion, but or is this really high-quality code? Or same in university, I mean, you can pass your semester, but is this really the kind of quality that people out in the real world expect? And I started looking at applications, which I'm using myself. So, for instance, like small programs like CAT, how do they work? Basically, you can think about what would you do yourself, but is this really what other people have done? And you're basically building up the competences, how these programs work. I mean, these are small examples, not that relevant in a professional environment, but there are others. That's just a Spring Framework. I mean, surely there are many people using Spring Framework, but how many people really understand this in detail, how it works? And this you can learn by examining the source text. And just think about what the programmers have thought about, and if you do this for many projects, you can get better at understanding other people's code, and I can confirm this from my own experience. And this really happens in real life quite a lot. If you start new in a company, or you're being drawn into a different project. As a freelancer, this happens to you all the time. And of course, you don't want to waste time unnecessarily by understanding code, but you need a routine. So this should also be fun, of course.
You can have fun by yourself, but also in a group. And we're going to talk about this further in this talk. Otherwise, we also have the situation of exchange of information, which is always important and hateful for others, so that I shouldn't only pass on my information to others, but the other way around as well, that others, you can learn from others as well. And as a senior developer, you can always also learn from junior developers, because when you are actually very aware of your own code, then you jump over issues or tickets because you never expect. Other people do not understand this, and this is always advantageous to change and with others and look at the code and review it together with other people, get a different point of view and have input like that. And we also are coming to the altruistic motivations. Once you found an issue, it's not necessary that you have to sell it. You can actually aid to fix it. You can correct it. You can make a feature extension once you understood what the issue is or what needs to be added here. And then you're actually part of the open source community. Not only that you are reviewing it, but that you're also practicing it. Not only you're using it. And once this is cleared up, the question remains, what is the way to do this in a group? Yeah, this is also the question, how can we do this format and how can we shape this? And we have a couple of questions or issues which we have to address. As Paldium explained, in larger groups, it would be a challenge. So we want to create an environment in which all people can learn together, every individual can get be heard, and thus this limits the size of the group. The next issue that we have is we need to enable everybody in the group to come along, to be able to follow. And we looked at a couple of things, and we considered whether it makes sense to make overflow videos and explain how we found this this false, these issues. Our issue was that it always appears that though this is very simple and easy, this very long process that you have, sometimes over several hours, is not really being displayed by doing this. So doing this video format, we decided against that, even though it's might be very sensible way for some people. It might also be that when you see a vulnerability, to then create a video like that, because explaining something might help yourself to understand the issue more clearly. The other possibility would be larger meetings in groups. So we don't want to reinvent the wheels. Open source scene and community are, there's obviously or there's surely some people who already do it this way. And we were right. We found some people. There used to be the OpenBSD Daily, which used to be 1 hour a day in an IRC channel, where he wrote what he is thinking about doing a code review that he is currently doing. And previously, before this talk, we wrote to him and said, "Hey, we're trying to make a talk about this, about the code review group. What do you think would be a sensible format in order to reach a large audience? How can you scale this?" And his answer was, maybe make a Twitch stream where three people together in one stream are doing a code review, one after the other, and they explain what is happening and what they're thinking about, what their considerations are. For me personally, this would not be very good for me, because I ignore things when they're very long, and so this follow along a 3 hour video would be tricky for me. But there's other people that are doing code review, for example, Code Reading Club. They had a similar issue. They thought, okay, we do a code reading club. We can't be that many people. And they did this in a Zoom session, and bam, they had the first time had a much too large group. So they had to limit the participants so that not everybody could partake in every instance. The consequence of this, what is it for us? It is that at the point when we asked ourselves which formats we can use, at that point we had already sort of understood which format would work well for us. And it might work for you as well. So how are we handling this? How does a code review look for us? Code review 3H2 way. or the H3 way. The 3H2 is our Capture the Flag group in Hamburg. And in the meantime, we are sitting on for 3 months already doing code reviews. And it all things started when Haldium wrote, "Hey, I'm doing a lot of code reviews in my spare time, and I would like to do this together with other people and maybe explain this to people. Is there anybody interested?" And initially, he did not expect the impact that it had. And now we've been doing it for 3 months. And initially, we had a fixed date in the week. Now we have two fixed dates during the week. Most importantly, is to say that our approach and our goal. That our goal is not to find vulnerabilities. That's also, of course, a goal. But our main aim is to learn how to make a code review, what approach to do, what the methodology should be, which sources we should use, what are the documentations, and where can I find them. And that's why we most often switch the projects which we review. We started with less. That was due to the fact that we did not know how to act once we find security relevant vulnerabilities, and the chance for this was very low there. So we started with that, and we also found a couple of things which was highly motivating, that we actually did find something and it didn't take hours. And dear Mark Rudemann accepted our change request, and by now we are at OpenSSH. We are at OpenSSH. And a further reason why we are changing our project is because not everybody always has time. When you have two meetings a week, it's kind of tricky because you all have a real life and a job. So not at every date and time everybody can be present. So we change around the project so that people who are coming new or spontaneous don't have such a high learning curve. You know this maybe as well. When you're working into a new code base, it takes a long time, and it also is difficult when you join a group newly to be able to orient yourself. How are we doing it? We meet Thursdays evenings and Sundays afternoon, and Palium usually brings a project with him. Before, now it's at 8, before it was left, and then we look at this. And we do this in the way one person is sharing the screen, and we go line by line through the code, we step through it, and the person that's stepping through it is explaining what is happening, and we jump to functions and so on and so forth. And what is important for us is that everybody gets to take part and gets to take a turn, and that we also leave room for everybody to talk, and everybody has a chance to ask questions. I'm still studying, so I don't have the immense programming experience with C. We have people among the group that are very, very experienced and have lots of knowledge about operating system, but we're trying to, or we're creating an environment in which every question is okay. Very often, these questions are helping us to discover new things that weren't clear to the others. That in regards to our approach, and we hope that we caught you all and got you hooked, and you can find your own group, start your own group. But maybe you don't know how to do this. How should I approach this? How should I do code review? So Palium has collected some approaches how one can do this and what is recommended.
Genau.
Exactly. So one can imagine you sitting together in a group and decided upon a project and are happy or asking oneself what we're going to do first. The project can be 10,000 or 100,000 or with some kernels even more lines of code, which might be off-putting especially as a beginner. How you're going to approach this when you don't have a developer who can explain this, it might be even more difficult. So even in our group, we have experience with different approaches to this. One would be, might sound strange, but it's actually working quite well, is you sort the file and you go alphabetically through the files. Or you can sort them by size, file size, and go them by size, and step through them by size. It just has the advantage that you're going to be thrown into it somewhere along the line, and you have no understanding what is happening at that point of. And this is the large benefit of this approach. You don't know where you are, you only have the code, and you have to, from that code, deduct what work upon what is happening. And this has the advantage that you're not being biased by what you imagine or believe the code is doing, but you actually have to read the code and understand what it's doing. And by doing this, you find discrepancies quite quickly. So you look at the code, you imagine what it's for, you try to understand it, and when what you see is not what you expect the code to do, then you find the issue. So if you have functions that are not doing what they're supposed to be doing, or edge cases where a huge value can be entered to a function, or a very small value, which might not work for the way it is written. And this would mean that from that point, you would have to think, how can I reach this function which I just found? So it means to tag along and think, how do I have to execute the software in order, or the library? What do I have to do? What edge cases in order to come to this very function? And in this way, I have the possibility to find out.
A different approach would be that I look at the entrance point of the program, such as the main function, and based on this, I can then think about, so for instance, I'm calling cat with a file, and think about what is the code path. So I step through the debugger step by step, think about what's happening, what could happen, and then I can try thinking about what would happen if I'm doing something different at a certain place, whatever you can imagine, or what happens if I concatenate a pipe. So these are things, if I take that approach, that I will never reach any dead code. So there's no point in jumping into any method which I can't reach. And that way you would not see methods that aren't being used at all. Another thing that might happen in both approaches is that you find something which has not been programmed correctly. So you find a bug. And you can think about, is this the only part which has been used in this way? And I can start looking for the same pattern in other programs. So this approach has been taken in the OpenBSD project. So as soon as a bug was found, the entire code base was examined to see if this bug occurred elsewhere. This has led to some new ideas, such as L-copy and so on. So you could also look at the history of a file to find out what was fixed in the past, get an understanding of the bugs that happened in the past, and to see if they might occur in other projects as well. The other thing that we want to give you in this talk, the idea is to look at the specifications. So for instance, of an audio format or an archiving program, to see how is this application meant to work, what is the basic idea behind it, so that we can see if all the applications that I'm using have thought about all the different points and put them down at the specifications. For instance, they might be written in an ambiguous way and leave room for interpretation. And it might miss certain points, and then the program Can we compare to other programs that run into the same situation to see how the other programs are dealing with it?
If you imagine that you found a place, a spot in the code which you assume or you assume to have an issue, it would be good to do a proof of concept, a so-called POC. This means you have to look how do I have to run or call the program or the library in order to reproduce this error. So this is good for beginners or even experienced people to really be ensure that what you just found is an issue. And with this proof of concept, you can then write a bug report or even attempt a patch and then do a pull request or an issue where you can very clearly describe, dear developer or maintainer, when you're using your software with the following input, there is a crash or I can maybe execute code or whatever. So that you can then elaborate and say, this are my example data and this is the patch that I would recommend to solve it. And the author or the maintainer can then decide to implement this fix or not. But this is also when it's security relevant, this is then possible to have negative consequences like privilege escalation or servers where I can see the data of a different user. One should not publicize these issues, which is why we as a group were unsure how to handle security issues. So one should contact the maintainer privately or over a bug bounty broker, depending on how you want to handle this. This is up to everybody themselves. But especially you have to be careful with this kind of publications. And these are the points or issues which are important to us and how to do a code review. Because looking at the time of our talk and the audio feed, this might not be sufficient for everybody. We have aggregated some links. So we have the code review guide, which is rather focused on web services, but this doesn't have to be an issue, especially when you're working in a web environment, a web service environment, this might be very helpful. How to look at code sources for my company, how am I looking at frameworks which I'm using, what are the points there, and then the idea for the bug hunters. This means that people who might want to have some reward or financial compensation for it, they could then look at what Google is saying about this topic. Google has a very good example. Where they in their development environment are doing code reviews. These are, of course, the trained reviews. So two developers are working together and are looking what needs to be inserted. It seems more like a code audit than a code review, looking at the existing plate. And then the projects which you already mentioned, we have the third last, the link to OpenBSD Daily from Vault. There, he doesn't only have all his results, which he found, but also his thoughts about this written down. One can easily read this. Then we have the Rust Code Reading Club. That is the reading club who is looking at the Rust code. Looking at the Rust compiler C code, depending on where they are in the project, then we have the code reading club. That would be codereading.org. There one can very beautifully turn to them when one thinks that this is an interesting topic, but I'm not sure whether there are groups. How's the landscape in this? They have a good contact possibility via email. And one can write them saying, hey, I'm interested in this topic, I'm in this area or subject, or I might need support with my, and they help. Definitely, and support one in a good sense. With this, what we have thought about how to do the code review. I'm getting back. Yeah, thank you. One small notation. When we have some bugs, we ask for money for pizza, which is kind of a cool thing, and we can all be agree on that. And even Marta, but there's definitely no struggle about who gets the reward, because pizza and Marta are best shared. So our tips for you and our recommendation is, when you think this is cool and I want to like to do this, initially I did not dare to do this because I'm not as good enough, make groups, get together, look for other people in your environment. Maybe there are other people that you feel comfortable with, that you want to start a project like this. This might be in your hackerspace, in your university. Maybe you tweet about it and find people that you can do this. Then, very important, in order to pull it, to follow through, find a recurrent date and time, because if you have full schedules or things happen unexpectedly, it is more easily consistent when you have a fixed slot for this time slot. Then, not so trivial, agree on a programming language. Can be a programming language that you know very well. It is definitely sensible to have someone that is very versed in this programming language, because otherwise you might not be able to see certain things. And when questions arise, you might you often need someone to talk about this. That is a crucial point. When I'm making a code review group at my university, for example, we're doing all of our education with Java, then I would probably found a group that is reviewing Java, because the chance of finding people that can are proficient in Java is quite large. And when people want to join that are not so versed in programming or coding, then could aid them and support them. So always crucial to look at other people, let them read the code, let them ask questions. If they don't know something, this is not a non-issue. It's just important that they learn it. Then look for a cool project. You can do this with different motivations. You can maybe say that you're using certain software like Git. So I'm looking at the code of Git because I know how the tool works. So I'm trying to understand how the code works. Or you can say, well, we want to be motivated. I'm going to look for a tool that has some issues, or where I can find certain things in order to be stay up with it. This is something that one can do with a project selection.
So, like Palladium said before, or when you deal with security-related things, maybe initially you want to think that isn't as critical. And make sure you have a community so you can ask someone. Be patient, that's also important.
So, I don't
mean patient initially, set everything up, but once you have started, for instance, we do Thursdays, 2 hours, you need to have patience with yourself. So you won't find something in the first 2 hours. In our case, for instance, Palladium might have already found something, says, well, there's something fishy here. And then we start from the beginning, and sometimes we get some initial support, which makes things faster. But when we look at software ourselves, we need sometimes 2 or 3 sessions until we have found something. New questions might come up, and so on. So, code reviews and finding bugs is not something where you find something and finish it after 1 hour of a video call, but it takes effort. You need to create a proof of concept, and then you find something else, or you might find a bug somewhere. So, make the effort to
es nicht so viel Aufwand ist,
think about
wie man
it.
Das lösen kann.
How does problem be solved? Open source projects aren't that many people who carry the weight, and they will gladly accept the fix if you can provide one. When in doubt, then you should ask. So maybe someone in your group knows someone who knows someone if you are unsure, and there's no problem. I mean, it's no issue if you have to ask questions. In my opinion, there's always someone somewhere who can answer a question or explain a problem, but make sure you have the question clearly stated. And finally, be excellent to each other. Everyone should be confident. And that means no one's being made fun of. And you shouldn't say, how come you don't know this, or something similar, because this might lead to people just dropping off, not coming back, and they won't learn anything. It's important that we all deal with this, and if you really want to do this, then you should have the opportunity to do these code reviews. In my opinion, my experience, this really helps a lot in my understanding of how software works. Instead of just creating code that helps you think about other people's code. So, this only leaves me to say that we love cats. So, be a cool cat and do code reviews. Go to a code reading club or create one yourself. Look at open source software, think about it. And if you have any questions, or to start a group or to organize it when you're stuck, here are my Twitter handle and the one of the C3H2 group, CTF group in Hamburg. You can also find me on GitHub. And what I just remembered, which we haven't said before, how do you connect? So for us, the best thing is group calls in Signal. You can also share your screen in Signal now, which is really helpful. Other than that, we use with people, external people, we use Jitsi. Paljan, you want to say something about our technical setup?
Kann ich noch so sagen?
Yes. So, with video conferences, everyone has seen this, doesn't always work that well, especially about upload.
Wenn denn die Uploadrate
so, this could be an issue where the upload bandwidth is not that much, so you can connect to a server, create a session there, and share the terminal with everyone. For instance, you could do it such a way that only one person can operate the terminal, everyone else has read write, then you just need to coordinate who's writing what.
Hat ja auch Spaß gemacht.
Ja, and genau, was fun as well.
Dazu und dann,
so much for that.
Sind wir hiermit durch. Hoffen, dass ihr schon
so, we're done with the talk and hopefully you've already cloned your first repo and I just opened it in your console.
Fragen in unserer Q&A Session.
And now we're looking forward to questions in our Q&A Session.
Das haben wir bisher nicht. Vielleicht sollten wir mal mit Bianca Kaste sprechen.
We did not do this so far. Maybe we have to talk to Bianca Katze, how this works with the communication with the government. This is our private project in a way. We are very taken aback by all the reaction. So maybe we can find a small code review movement together.
A little note from the translators here. Unfortunately, we can't hear the questions from the Herald.
Yeah, gerne.
Alim, do you want to? Yeah, thank you. Well, the test cases should be ideally during a pull request be commented in order to clarify that it's an issue. It happened to me quite a lot that people replied, thank you for the corrections, but can you supply a test case? So one should provide this if possible, and then hope for the maintainer to support one, because there's many frameworks where it's difficult.
Also, es ist eine gute Frage.
That's a good question. I think it is the same as when one is doing scientific papers and has to learn how to do that. It's always helpful to read a lot of code from others in order to get a feeling for how to solve problems. But one does not cannot avoid to find your own projects and program itself, because you only get better in programming when actually doing programming. So that's the way I handle this. Maybe Palium has a diverging opinion. Well, the reviews all help a lot in order to get a sort of fine-grained finalization. So if I look at the project's history to understand why they chose certain changes and when did the changes happen. So I would suggest that once the basics are understood, with the code review, one can improve. Just doing review in order to learn, I wouldn't recommend.
Wir haben gerade Probleme mit unserem Herald.
We're having some issues with our Herald, as earlier. That's why, after a quick interruption, we're going to continue. I'd like to connect to that earlier question, the question whether there is a collection of often seen issues. Palium, is there a collection of common issues? I would all mention the CVE IDs or the Open Source Security Bug Tracker. Otherwise, the things which I would point to is OWAT. That means the top 10 of the issues that shows quite well what issues are there. It's almost a small, quick search for the programming languages and common bugs should suffice and result in a lot of lists like this. When it's talking about C and the manual pages on News Day may be interesting, they might have notes or other input what is going wrong with a certain function. Thank you. Do we have Herald audio?
Die haben wir bisher tatsächlich ignoriert.
With those we have ignored so far. Maybe we should add them, but yeah. But we try to focus on the source code, which we are using, and so the test files are not included.
Wir haben immer noch Audioprobleme mit uns.
We still have audio issues with our Herald. One moment, please.
Die Frage war, wenn der gleiche
when the same issue, the same error is done again in another project, So for example, if I'm using the wrong function, but how can I do it when I found an issue which violates programming principle, which I cannot find across all the files with Control F, Command F. I'm thinking whether we had one issue like that. Do we have one like that, Paljo? I have seen a project in Google open source, which is being used. I forgot the name, but what I can recommend is it's almost the Control F codesearch.debian.net is a website from the Debian project where you can search across all source codes and use regex in order to look for things, and I would recommend using that examples until our Herald has audio again would be in C, fget, so line by line, read in. As soon as you have that line, you can look at the next line after that, and then you're probably going to find something. So it's still a lot of a bit of work. Google has a lot much better tools similar to regular expressions which you can use. Maybe I can link that or tweet that. Yeah, I can tweet that on my Twitter account. You can find that there. Is our Herald now back with audio? We try it again.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Are you working together when doing the code reviews?
Ich verstehe die Frage nicht so ganz. Ich versuche mal so zu antworten, wie Sie verstehen.
I'm not sure I understand the question. I try to answer the way I understood it. What we in our group do is not writing open source software. So we merely look at open source software and review it. And of course, when we find something, we write a fix for it and a proof of concept. And we create a pull request corresponding. Of course, before we do the pull request, we look at it in the group. But I would not wouldn't call that review. Review, we're doing this when the maintainer is not allowing the pull request, and we sometimes rewrite it.
In der Regel gibt es halt dann das
Projekt, usually, when the project that we look at with the pull request, they are the most relevant point, contains the most relevant points. Otherwise, we have not done this. If people are interested in this, we can consider this.
Wir machen das tatsächlich im Moment,
we do it the way that one person is sharing the screen and other people can individually work along in their own computer in the IDE of their choice. We're all hardcore Vim users.
Einsteigerfreundlich, aber
which might not be a starter and beginner friendly, but the IDE shouldn't be the limiting factor. And when it's Codium or whatever and you prefer that, then you can also do that. I would like to add one point there. The same environment, I would prefer when it's possibly mostly various and different IDEs, because many issues happen on 32 or 64-bit. They might only run when certain libraries are in use. So the more diverse, then it should be. Then that helps. It might make the communication a bit more difficult, but it enables a lot of much better proof of concepts or test production.
Ich würde jetzt sagen, einfach mal machen.
I would simply do that. Just I would say, go ahead and actually do it. I'm actually insisting that people have to do it in the work environment. It aids a lot. Whoever was inspired by the talk in order to do the code review will realize how much work it is to go into the different styles of the projects. And if that would all be the same, that would make it much simpler.
Ja, eigentlich schon. Das ist
yeah. Lustig. Also actually, yeah, it's true. It's always it's funny, especially C-style conventions, when it is pre-Chernobyl code, as Palium often says.
uns auch ganz wichtig und manchmal ist es auch
then that is also important for us and it's very very confusing for us to get into that mindset and then to also write the fixes in the correct style.
Hören wir Herr schon wieder nicht?
We don't hear him again.
Okay, die Frage eben.
Okay, the question was, how important for us is the style convention and what do we say about clean code? What was the question that Palium and I answered? I'm looking that I can get the next question. Unless the Herald is audible again.
Setz. Ich hoffe, man kann mich wieder hören. Setzt die Tools zur Code-Analyse ein.
Are you using tools for code analysis?
Das machen wir ganz bewusst nicht, weil wir...
Yeah, we don't do that very consciously because even when it takes longer, our focus is to understand what is happening and thus we except for Palium when our as our dictionary for C we don't use tools for analysis.
Geht es beim Reviewen darum, Bugs oder potenzielle
Schwachstellen? Is the point of reviewing to find bugs or potential weaknesses or also to optimize something or shorten the code? Then have you examples for this?
In principle, our goal is to find mistakes and bugs, but when one finds something that could be more efficient, we fix that often as well. I'm not actually, no example comes to mind. I need to look into my pull request history, unless you have some example, Palium. I actually don't. If it's regarding fixing bugs or performance optimization. In both cases, it would be important to point out and prove that the issue is actually impacting the performance. I try to abstain from performance optimizations almost consciously because it usually ends in discussions, and it's the question, how well can I resolve this with the maintainer? Is there an objective basis to work on this? For example, if I'm saying my LLS is too slow because a couple of milliseconds too slow, it's going to be probably disregarded. The pull request in a browser would be an issue, a different issue, but a bug is much more annehmbar. Much more easy to accept without discussion.
Schaut man sich beim Reviewen auch Ebenen wie
Design Patterns oder ähnliches? Also examining things like Design Patterns or similar during the code reviews.
Würde ich jetzt so sagen, nicht, es sei denn, es
stimmt. We, as I would say, don't do it unless we stumble upon it and we're keen on it. So it's always dependent on our mood. Because we do this for the fun. And if we have fun to pick it apart, then we would do it.
Palium, hast du dazu noch eine Ergänzung?
Otherwise, I'm not sure. Palium, do you have something to add? Architecture reviews, I would recommend. At least when you have the time for it, if you have the time for it. But the point is, the question is, what are you going to get from that? In order to question an architecture, I would at the most add an issue for that. Because if we do a pull request that changes all the architecture, the chances of this being ignored or disregarded is very high. So we often focus on what is there, what is found, what we see, and don't do that evaluation very public. But by doing the review, you are coming into contact with the architecture, and you understand whether it's good or bad. And this is something that you for yourself can learn.
Do you directly approach the maintainers before reviewing a specific project, or are you doing this through the pull requests after review?
Bisher haben wir das noch nicht gemacht.
So far we have not done this. When we found something which we found critical, we contacted the maintainers directly before we made public comments about this.
Kennt ihr Gruppen, die gerne bei Public Money, Public Code Projekten
mit Review? Do you know groups who would like to review projects in the area of public money, public code.
We only know ourselves and the aforementioned links.
Mehr kann ich da gerade nichts zu sagen.
I think I cannot say more regarding this right now. Anything else we need to talk in the group and come back.
Danke. Wir haben leider nicht alle Fragen.
Thanks a lot. Unfortunately, we haven't managed to go through all of the questions, but I have never had such a long Q&A before.
Auch noch andere Projekte bei
den and the speakers have other projects here at the C3.
Stellt mir sonst gerne die Fragen bei Twitter und Palium und ich versuche die so gut wie möglich zu beantworten. Ich denke, das ist
Otherwise, ask questions on Twitter and Palium and I try to answer it as well as we can.
Ich habe oft gefragt, wann die nächste News Show ist.
And all of I'm hearing when the news show is going to happen. The next news show is going to happen at 14:30. In case you want to, if you're missing my face and want to see me again, that would be an option.